truly has been a countywide collaborative effort. I want to give a shout out and a large thank you to our steering committee, if they could just wave their hands, and they're probably in a bright yellow shirt. Their names are in the program. They have put a lot of work into this event. And I also want to thank all of our sponsors and our manufacturing exhibitors. Today's events are designed to celebrate our county's manufacturing companies and to share with the community the incredible assets that we have in our own backyard. We are thrilled to have such a great turnout. This room is full, which is awesome. Includes over 250 students from every school district in the county. I think we also have a group of homeschooled students here, so that's really exciting as well. And we hope that all of you can stay after our presentation to check out all of the manufacturing exhibits, which will be in the West Hall. Now, it is my pleasure to introduce our keynote speaker sponsor, Westfield Brew, represented by Joe Coleman. Joe is the treasurer and Westfield Brew finance leader. In short, he's the money guy, so we want to be nice to him. And they've been a great partner. They're very, very involved in community and economic development efforts. Both Westfield Insurance and Westfield Bank have been tremendous supporters of this event, and we appreciate your sponsorship. So please help me welcome Joe Coleman, who will introduce our keynote speaker. Joe?
It's great to be here this morning, and today is a celebration of sorts. First, we're celebrating the showcase opportunities that exist within the manufacturing field, specifically here in Medina County. And second, we should celebrate the success of this high-impact collaboration effort to put this showcase together. So thanks to everybody who's been involved in that. I have the pleasure of serving on the board of the Medina County Economic Development Corporation, and we have many other leaders at Westfield engaged in various chambers and regional boards. Our chairman and past CEO, Jim Clay, currently serves as the board chair for Team NEO. Westfield commits significant time and money to these organizations because it's very important work advancing economic growth, which is critical for our county, our region, and our state. It's vital for us to remain competitive. I'm sure I speak for many others in saying that I hope the work and the conversations continue, as it's critical for job creation, job preparedness, and job access. The manufacturing industry specifically is important to Westfield. About 10% of our customers in Ohio are specifically in the manufacturing field. And there are more than 50 of those operating right here in Medina County. How wonderful it is to dedicate a day to raise awareness about the opportunities that exist in manufacturing. Westfield can certainly appreciate the challenges at hand because the insurance industry shares the need to fill a large talent gap. We too are working hard to attract talent to our industry that is also misunderstood at times. But we are faced with the need to fill 26,000 jobs that will be available just in Ohio by the year 2020. And we are working through many collaborative efforts like these to raise awareness of the jobs that are available in insurance in our region, but more broadly in our state. Westfield is very proud to be part of today, and we hope to be a significant part of the continuing conversation about job creation and manufacturing in Medina and the region. I was really happy today to be asked to introduce Thomas Frey. Last May, Thomas was the keynote speaker at Westfield's annual meeting and spoke to a group of over 1,000 agents and employees of Westfield. I'm really excited for you to hear from him and know that today that you will leave here thinking very differently about your future. I know just talking to Thomas for a few minutes this morning, my head is already spinning about a number of things. I understand you have Thomas's bio, so I won't read that to you, but Thomas is the senior futurist at the Da Vinci Institute in Colorado in the Denver area, and has been rated as Google's top futurist speaker. Over the past decade, Thomas has built an enormous following around the world, and his ability to develop accurate visions of his future and describe the opportunities that those create put him at the front of his field. Talking to him this morning, he just came in from Holland last night, heading back out to Denver and then to New Zealand. So he truly is a speaker on a worldwide basis and has tremendous insight into what he does. But he does, his work is not just restricted to advances in technology, but rather takes a much larger view of the landscape and the playing field and the opportunities and challenges those present. Each year he speaks to thousands of people, and I'm sure today you will leave feeling a little bit, you know, confused, but also hopefully thinking about the opportunities that exist and embrace those opportunities instead of fearing those opportunities. I'd also suggest if you have some increased interest, check out his website, his blogs. There's many YouTube videos of other speeches he has done, so many of them are very interesting on many different topics. So with that, please welcome Thomas Frank.
All right, thank you. It is indeed a great honor to be here with you today. All right, let's see if we've got this working right. Isn't technology wonderful? All right, I'm gonna start off by giving you a little bit of history here. Because futurists actually spend a lot of time thinking about history. And so that's a very important subject in school. We have a division of the Da Vinci Institute called the Visionarium. This is one where we actually work with companies and we help them create visions of the future for their industry. So I'll take you on some of those processes this morning. In 1946, these three gentlemen actually were working late one night and they discovered something that was pretty amazing, but they didn't really quite understand what it was that they were working on. This John Bardeen, Walter Brattain, and William Shockley. These three gentlemen went on to win the Nobel Prize, and the guy that thought he was the head of all this was William Shockley, and so he decided to leave Bell Labs where they were working and start his own business in California called Shockley Semiconductors in 1956. So because he was a Nobel Prize winner, lots of people knew him, he was able to recruit very talented people to come to work at Shockley Semiconductors. But he was kind of a jerk. Nobody really liked him. So as a result, these top-notch people that he had recruited from all over the world were sitting around plotting against him. And there's these eight guys. These eight guys became known as the Traitorous Eight. And the Traitorous Eight left Shockley Semiconductor and they started a new company called Fairchild Semiconductor. And Fairchild Semiconductor is still alive today and it's responsible for lots of other companies. So some of the Traitorous Eight were Robert Noyce. He's the guy that invented the integrated chip, integrated circuit. Gordon Moore, you've probably heard of Moore's Law. He was one of those. Eugene Kleiner started Kleiner Perkins, one of the dominant venture capital firms in the Bay Area. And as a result of these guys coming out of Shockley Semiconductor, they spawned almost all of the startup companies in Silicon Valley. So over the next couple decades, virtually every startup company had some ties to Fairchild Semiconductor. These became known as the Fair Children. But we're a very backward-looking society. We like stories like that because they resonate with us. See, we've all personally experienced the past. As we look around us, we see evidence of the past all around us. All information we come into contact with is essentially history. So the past is very knowable, and yet we're going to be spending the rest of our lives in the future. So it's almost as if we're walking backwards into the future. My job as a futurist is to help turn people around, to give them some idea of what the future might hold. So exactly how does the future get created? What is our relationship with the future? The future gets created in the minds of everybody around us. We're all participating in creating the future. Certainly some of us have more influence than others. But people make decisions today based on their understanding of what the future holds. So I use this phrase a lot, the future creates the present. This is just the opposite of what most people think. Most people think that what we're doing today is going to somehow create the future. But from a little different perspective, it's these visions of the future that we hold in our head determine our actions today. So here's the key thing. If we change somebody's vision of the future, we will change the way they make decisions today. And that's my promise to you. I promise before you leave here today, I'm going to change your vision of the future. And you'll make different decisions as a result of that. So if I don't do that, please hold my feet to the fire. I'll do my best. But first, I have a disclaimer. As a futurist, I get asked a lot, do you have a crystal ball? And yes, I do have a crystal ball. It was sitting around at home. And my wife says, why don't you just take this to the office? It's just collecting dust here. So I put it in the car, and I was driving down the road. I was no more than like 4 or 5 minutes down the road. I looked over, and I saw that my crystal ball had started a fire on the seat next to me. So this is a giant lens, the sun shining in. This is like Boy Scouts 101. I should have known better. Luckily, I was able to put out the fire and it didn't cause any serious damage. But then I had this revelation. Obviously, it came from my crystal ball. The revelation was that the newspaper headlines the next day were going to say, futurist killed by his own crystal ball. And he didn't see it coming. So that's like the ultimate insult for a futurist. So that's my disclaimer. I don't see everything. So. Larry Page says the main reasons companies fail is because they miss the future. I happen to agree with that. People are getting blindsided by the future because it's happening right underneath their feet and they're not aware of it. All right, we're going to start off with this quick exercise here. The most famous person in the world. Who's the most famous person of all time? Just yell out a name. Okay. Kim Kardashian, Warren Buffett, yeah. It has to be in the non-religious sense. So. So I hear lots of interesting names. Because I run the Da Vinci Institute, we came up with Leonardo da Vinci. But there's some other names, Christopher Columbus, Isaac Newton, Einstein, Edison, Gandhi, maybe Oprah, Nelson Mandela, maybe Zuckerberg. But sadly, our researchers have looked into this and they found that the most famous person in the world today is actually this guy. Who knew? Yeah. But I was thinking about this question for a while, about the most famous person, and it occurred to me that the most famous person of all time probably hasn't been born yet, or we don't know who that person is. Now, this should be a very inspiring thought because there's an opening. You could become that person. The next logical question is that what is the accomplishment that will make that person so famous? So what are the big things that still need to be accomplished in the world? Ah, there's lots of them. So let me take you through the scenario here. The year is 2020. This is just 5 years down the road. The Norwegian Nobel Committee decides that they want to use a little different process for selecting the winners of the Nobel Peace Prize. So they decide to hold a global election. There's a new secure software that's been developed, and they want people to vote on who the winner of the Nobel Peace Prize should be. So they want to use this process to inspire a new age of peace. And so they start with by selecting four nominees. So they pick the panel of four nominees, and then they announce it 60 days before the election, 24-hour election cycle, and you can use any electronic device to cast your vote. Now, they want people to know more about each of the candidates than just the name. They don't want people to just go on there and select the name, so they want people to know who they are and what they accomplish. So they pre-test people. They ask two rudimentary questions about each of the candidates, not intending to trip people up, but to give them more background information. And they get four attempts, so that's not designed to disqualify people. So the election day comes, the winner gets announced, 740 million people are voting from 50 different countries, and suddenly the winner becomes the most famous person on earth. Is that a realistic scenario? Some of you will say yes, some of you will say no. But this is an interesting new technology. This is something different. This is what I refer to as catalytic innovation. That's different than disruptive innovation. Disruptive innovation disrupts existing industries. Catalytic innovation creates entire new industries. So are we going to have global elections that change the course of history from here on out? Maybe. So examples of catalytic innovation in the past are things like electricity, cars, airplanes, telephones, photographs. Each of these went on to create multi-billion dollar industries. But here's the thing. All industries are a bell curve. They have a beginning, a middle, and an end. All industries will eventually end. 1,000 years from now, every industry that we have today will be gone and be replaced with something else. The other thing that pay really close attention to is that most of the profitable industries today happen to be in the second half of the bell curve, constantly being forced to do more with less. So let me give you a quick example. This affects the manufacturing world in a big way, kind of. We'll talk about peak steel. Projections are that we will run into the peak demand for steel in the world sometime around 2024. That's when we develop synthetic materials and the overall demand for steel will start to decline. Now, the peak employment in the steel industry happened in the 1980s. In the US, the peak employment was three times as many people were working in the steel industry as we have today, but we're still producing far more steel. So the peak employment actually is a lead indicator. It could be several decades ahead, but it's a lead indicator as when sometime in the future there will be an overall decline in the demand for that goods or service, whatever that industry is about. So as my favorite physicist Max Planck likes to say, when you change the way you look at things, the things you look at change. A few months ago, I made the prediction that by 2030, over 2 billion jobs are going to go away. Now, when I made this prediction, it wasn't intended to be some doom or gloom statement. We're not going to have 2 billion people unemployed in the world. It's intended to be a wake-up call that we're going to have to replace jobs at a faster rate than ever before. There is this very pervasive anxiety in the world today. Is my job still going to be around 5 years from now? Lots of people have that nagging anxiety in the back of their heads. This is what I refer to as the level problem. A lot of us have this tool in our garage, the level. We use it for hanging pictures, we use it for doing construction. But once we are able to download a Level app, then suddenly we don't need to buy that tool. That means that we don't have to have the people make the aluminum frame for it. We don't have to have the people make the glass bulbs, the assembly work to put it all together, the shipping and the receiving, the retail stores that are handling that product. Every time we download a mobile app, we're eliminating a piece of a job. It's a very tiny piece, but when we're downloading billions and billions of mobile apps, it amounts to lots of unemployment. Oxford researchers analyzed skills for 700 different occupations and concluded that machines will take over 47% of today's jobs. Coincidentally, that works out to about 2 billion. If we look at the commercial airline industry, in the early 1970s, we still had 5 people in the cockpit of airplanes: the pilot, the co-pilot, the flight engineer, radio operator, and the navigator. We've automated 3 of those positions out of existence, and now the FAA is taking a look at automating out the co-pilot as well. We very likely could actually fly the plane without any pilot at all, but emotionally, we're not quite ready for that. When it comes to sharing economy companies like Uber and Airbnb, they have figured out how to automate out middle management positions, and they're doing it with software. So it's not just the low-level jobs that are going away, it's a lot of high-level jobs as well. This is a robotic chef that is making over 2,500 different recipes. Wouldn't you like to go to that restaurant? Every meal is exactly the way it should be. Chinese company is actually trying to figure out how to create this zero labor factory, which is ironic because they actually have more people than any other country. So yeah, let's just automate them all out of work. But entrepreneurs have a way of sniffing out where the money is. They know where the money's at, and so they gravitate to the opportunities. So as an example, there's no safe industries today. In the fintech space — fintech is financial technology space, that's this emerging area for startups — there are now over 8,000 startups in this space in the United States, fueled by $12 billion in VC money. I like to think of these startups, and that this will affect all banking and finance companies, I like to think of these as the little piranhas that are each taking a bite out of the big whale. Kind of death by 1,000 paper cuts, something like that, or by 8,000. So on one hand, we are eliminating jobs. On the other hand, we're freeing up human capital. But just because there aren't enough jobs to do doesn't mean we've run out of work. You know, it's kind of ludicrous to say, yeah, there's no work left to do in the world. Yeah, right, have you looked around lately? But having jobs lined up for all the work that needs to be done, that's a whole nother issue. We will still have a lot of problems there, a lot of gaps. So what role should economic development play in the creation of new business and industry in a community? That's going to be changing over time. Because of all this pervasive thinking about jobs going away and no work left to do, I put together the 3 laws of exponential capabilities. And I'll just go through these quickly here. The first law is that with automation, every exponential decrease in effort creates an equal and opposite exponential increase in capabilities. So essentially, when something's easier to do, we'll just do more of it. I'll give you a quick example. In 1850, the average transportation speed in the United States was 4 miles an hour. A lot of people on horse and buggy, walking around. And over a lifetime, the average person would go 73,000 miles. That's an entire lifetime. That's the distance that a human would travel. 1900, we got up to 8 miles an hour. By 1950, we hit 24 miles an hour. And then in 2000, because so many people were flying, we actually reached 75 miles an hour on average. So if you're following this trend line, by 2050, we should actually be hitting around 225 miles an hour. And over our lifetime, we go from 73,000 miles to 7.3 million miles. That's an exponential increase. That's a 100-fold increase in the distance traveled by a human being over their lifetime in 200 years. That's very significant. Law number two, as we raise the bar for our achievements, we also reset the norm for our expectations. So we're just going to start thinking about accomplishing more. And as today's significant accomplishments become more common, mega accomplishments will take their place. So we're entering the era of mega projects. So we can now think faster, know faster, do faster than ever before in history. So where will our next generation of jobs come from? The answer is very simple, from future industries. So we're going to look at a few of those today. So this is a real important piece here about exponential change. We tend to think linearly. Things are increasing, but we're not thinking exponentially. So over 2 years, we might have two changes. Over 10 years, rather than having 10 changes, exponential change would indicate we're going 32 times as fast. So as we transition companies from the physical world into the digital world is moving much faster. So as an example, the adoption speed for different industries, radio, it took 38 years to hit 50 million users. TV came along 13 years, and then we thought Twitter was really fast at 9 months, and then along came Angry Bird and did it in 35 days. We're now at a point where somebody could conceivably start a company and actually have 50 million users in just a day or two. That's entirely possible. We have that ability to scale exponentially. It's kind of crazy. So we're transitioning from the physical to the digital, from physical cars to digital cars, from physical homes to smart homes, from physical cities to smart cities. And each time we make this transition, the changes start happening exponentially. That's why things are changing so quickly around us. So if we look at this, I like to think of the power of 10 interface. If somebody was sitting in a big library 20 years ago, and you asked them a series of really tough questions, it could very likely take them 10 hours to find an answer. Today, using a keyboard and a search engine, we can get the answer in 10 minutes. So going from 10 hours to 10 minutes. The next interface is the 10-second interface. Can we put some sort of a cap on our head that and somebody asks us a question, and we can instantly think an answer in 10 seconds. This is the area of neurotechnology. There's lots of people working on this. We're not there yet. But once we get to the 10-second interface, suddenly education changes a lot. Suddenly we don't have to teach the who, the what, the when, the where. We just have to teach the why and the how. And I understand this grossly oversimplifies everything. But it's changing things dramatically if we have access to all that fundamental knowledge. So I will mention a few kind of macro trends as we go through the day here. The first is that future industries will define the systems needed by the workforce of tomorrow. We'll start with the Internet of Things. Mark Andreessen is the guy that started Netscape. He runs one of the leading venture capital firms in the Bay Area. He makes a statement a lot, software is eating the world, and it really is. We're putting a layer of software infrastructure over everything physical in the world. We're connecting things that we never thought connectable in the past. A lot of it's happening through the Internet of Things. To give you some background on this, the Internet of Things is actually something that Cisco, the company, recognized somewhere between 2008 and 2009. That's when the number of devices connected to the internet started to exceed the number of people on Earth. 6.8 billion people on Earth, 6.8 billion devices. And now the projection is that we'll hit 50 billion things connected to the internet by 2020. At the same time, 2 years ago, there was the people at Fairchild Semiconductor put together an event called the Trillion Sensor Summit. And they were charged with putting together a roadmap as to how long it would be before we reach a trillion sensors in the world. And when I'm talking about sensors, I'm talking about heat sensors, light sensors, chemical sensors. We can sense millions of different things. They concluded that we will reach a trillion sensors in the world in 2024, and that by 2036, we will have 100 trillion sensors in the world. Now, what this means is that the sensors become very tiny, very ubiquitous. They're very inexpensive to produce, and we start embedding them in coatings and paints and powder coatings. We start putting them on the sides of cars, on the sides of houses, on the sides of bridges. We have information coming from everywhere. We put sensors in our clothing. As a result of this, innovation is being parsed into far smaller pieces. That means every one of us can participate. Every one of us can make changes that affect the entire world. So there's a certain category of these Internet of Things devices that I find absolutely fascinating. It's called enchanted objects. These have magical properties. And so I'll just go through a few of these here. The first one is the Amazon trash can. So once you finish something that you're using, you throw it away, it automatically scans the can when you throw it away and it reorders it from Amazon. You know, Amazon really likes this product. Can't imagine why. This is the MemoMe smart mirror. So if you're trying on clothes, it will remember what you look like in your last outfits, so you can compare them side by side. And since this is a smart mirror, it will always make you look better than your friends. The Vitality Glow Cap, you have to take medicine at 8 o'clock every morning. This will remind you by having a little light that flashes on the top. And if you still don't take your pills, it'll start chirping. And if you still don't take them, then it'll start sending you text messages. So this thing will nag you until you get your pills. The biometric coffee maker, this thing's really smart. You get up in the morning, you put your hand on it, it knows exactly how much caffeine you need in your coffee. the first time we had a standing ovation for a machine. We think it should have a Jack Daniel's switch on it too, but. These are smart chopsticks invented by the Chinese search engine Baidu, which is very good because you can tell if the food is safe to eat just by using these chopsticks. The only bad side is you have to know how to use chopsticks. I love this one here, the Flying Nixie camera. It looks like a kind of a watch thing. You just unlatch it turns into a little drone that you throw like a frisbee, and then you can go spy on your neighbors. I mean, who wouldn't want one of those? And because we're going to have such a food shortage, probably not. But anyway, this is a kitchen appliance for breeding fly larvae. Really looks yummy, doesn't it? The Pinto Feed pet feeder. Any of you that have pets at home, you can dispense the food remotely, and then you can FaceTime your pets. So if you have pets at home and you're not FaceTiming them, well, shame on you. And this one here is a great one. It's called No More Wolf. It's actually a pet translator, so it'll tell you what they're barking about. And the good thing is it looks so good on them. So I'll shift gears here and tell you about atmospheric water harvesters. Lots of concern about water in the world. Of all the water in the world, only 2% of it is fresh water. And for a variety of reasons, only about 25% of the fresh water is actually accessible to human beings. So the entire human race has survived until now with just 0.5% of all the water in the world. We think there's a better way. Atmospheric water harvesters are sometimes look like this. This is something called fog nets. They suck moisture out of the air in a humid area. This is a MIT research project in Peru. A French designer came along and created what's called the Warka water towers. These are designed for remote villages in Africa, and they can get 25 gallons of water a day. And this dramatically changes the lives of young girls in Africa because they're the ones that have to haul all the water. The guys are kind of lazy over there. And they've actually figured out how to train them on building their own towers. It takes 4 people a week to build their own towers, and then they're off and running. Another French company, Eoli Water, has figured out how to use windmills to suck moisture out of the air. They're testing these out in Abu Dhabi, and they're getting around 125 gallons a day, depending on the humidity. And Edward Leniger, a young inventor, figured out this company called Airdrop Systems, how to suck moisture out of the air and irrigate all the plants nearby. So this whole industry, as it was evolving, the holy grail for the industry was actually, can we create the self-filling water bottle? And then just a couple months ago, a company came up called Fontis. This isn't on the market yet today, but this is a self-filling water bottle that fits on bicycles. And as you drive along, it sucks moisture out of the air and fills the water bottle. Now, a self-filling water bottle, if you're stranded on a life raft in the middle of the ocean, this can mean the difference between life and death. If you're stuck in the middle of a desert, again, the difference between life and death. You can start seeing how interesting that would be if we had self-filling water bottles. I also think of this whole atmospheric water harvesting as changing our water supply system. We have it ingrained in our thinking that we need to work with our groundwater and our streams and our lakes, but what if we could just work with the atmosphere, and that's our conduit for water? It's a whole different way of thinking. You can't depend on your eyes when your imagination is out of focus. Mark Twain has some interesting ideas about these things. All right, another macro trend. 3D printing in the emerging hyper-individualized consumer marketplace. So I went to the Consumer Electronics Show in January, and the first booth I went to, they actually sat me down and they scanned the inside of my ears. Now, they took that image from the inside of my ears and they proceeded to 3D print earbuds for me. Now, these may not look like much, but these are the most comfortable earbuds I've ever owned because they fit my ears perfectly. And I started thinking, you know, how few things we actually own that are custom fitted for us personally. Naturally, this is going to take off in some interesting ways and be used in the hearing aid industry and lots of other areas. But I was in South Korea just a couple weeks ago, and they took me into this booth here. They had me pose, and instantly 100 cameras took my photo, and they turned it into a three-dimensional image, and they 3D printed a little statue of me about that tall in full color. So we are rapidly shifting from taking selfies to doing shapies. Now, who doesn't want their own statue? I mean, the 3D printing industry was started by this gentleman, Charles Hull, in the early 1980s. Originally, he was just printing in plastics and resins, but now we're able to print in hundreds of different materials. Some of the latest of smart wood, able to actually grind up wood and feed it into the fibers, into the filaments, and so that we can print with that. macadamia nut shells, and then the most bizarre one is instant tea. I'm not sure why they were thinking that was a good idea. But the number of things we can print with, you know, just 5 years from now will probably be in the thousands. So think about going into a clothing store 5 years from now, maybe 10. The first thing they do is they step you into a body scanner. They scan your entire body, and then you walk around the store and you pick out whatever fashion styles and colors you're interested in, and they 3D print your clothes right there while you're waiting. Now this is 3D printed clothing. We can create styles and fashions that are much more complicated than anything we have that you can create with needles and thread. I thought the one on the left would look good on me, but maybe not.
Just imagine the potential. If you're called, print your own jacket. Traveling with no luggage? Just print your clothes in the hotel room. Will we soon be able to design, share, and print our own clothes directly from home?
That's a young lady from Israel who printed all the clothes in that fashion show at home. She printed them herself. So we're still not ready for prime time on this because we can we haven't got the silks and the satin type feel for it yet. But that's coming very soon. And we can also print our shoes. So we're not just scanning our bodies, we're also scanning our feet. And I don't know anybody that doesn't have problems with their feet. So again, we're not quite ready for prime time with this yet, but we're getting very close. This is a company based in London that has figured out how to print the different layers of the sole and different levels of squishiness to create the perfect fit for our shoe. And so we're going to see a lot of experimentation like this over just the next few months even. So contour crafting is a version of additive manufacturing. It's a version of 3D printing working with concrete. So this shows one version of contour crafting where we're putting a layer of concrete on top of another layer upon another layer upon another layer. Now, when they were working on this, and they'd actually been working on this since 2003, there had been kind of a competition going on to see who could actually 3D print the first house. There was a Dutch group, there was one in Southern California, one in London, and then along came this Chinese group called Winsun, and incidentally, what they were printing was a castle. I mean, come on, everybody wants a castle. So this company, Winsun, actually 3D printed, not only printed the first house, they printed 10 houses in one day. And they were using recycled material that were ground up and put inside of this material. Very similar to what I just showed you. And then a few months ago, they showed us that they could print this entire 13,000 square foot mansion. Now, if you look closely at the corners, you can see it's a little bit crude around the edges, but it's a very durable structure. And not only did they print that mansion, they also printed this four-story building. So this is going to start influencing the way we do construction. This is kind of the vision that most people have, that we'll set up some sort of a rig around a construction site and start doing one layer upon another layer upon another layer. And only we're not just going to be printing the structure, we will soon be able to print the plumbing in the walls. We'll be able to print the wiring in the walls, the cabinets in the kitchens, the sinks and the toilets in the bathrooms. And here's the thing, if you get tired of your house, you can just grind it up and reprint it. The Chinese houses that they printed, on average, under $5,000. That's pretty amazing. This is a company in Slovenia Bed Abrams that's selling house printers for $16,000. So what are you waiting for? Once we're able to actually print our houses, we no longer have the need for flat walls. Every wall can become an artistic centerpiece. Architects are going to have a heyday with this because they can create these freeform structures unlike anything we see today. The definition of of our houses, of our buildings, is going to suddenly change. You can print with glass for a while, then steel, then concrete again. So what we think about as living structures, apartments, condos, houses, that's all going to shift. Architects are going to have a lot of fun with this. This kind of looks like a wad of paper in the middle of a city. And it's just a matter of scale before we can reach the big things, printing entire ships, printing baseball stadiums, printing post offices and hospitals. All of that is coming. Or floating islands. I really like floating islands. Bioprinting. This gentleman here is printing a human vein for surgery. This guy in China fell off scaffolding. He's a construction worker and lost a good chunk of his skull, and they 3D printed a replacement part and patched him up. You can actually now have your brain scanned and you can print out your brain and you set it on your desk. That's a real ego trip. Say, hey, my brain's bigger than your brain. So go to brainform.com, get your brain scanned. Vinod Khosla made this interesting statement. He's the most successful venture capitalist of all time. He says that big data is going to replace the need for 80% of all doctors. He's referring to these type of patches, these type of sensors that you put on your skin. Lots of information coming and going from these type of sensors. And then along came, this was just maybe a month ago, BioBots announced that they have this new machine that they're selling for under $10,000 that can actually print human tissue. So if you think in terms of being able to print human skin for burn victims, this is 3D printed human skin. The cosmetic industry is very interested in replacement skin because they've been ruining a lot of it. But what if we could actually print sensors into the skin? And so what if we could actually apply this extra skin over our existing skin and then we become like politicians, rhino skin, you know, really thick skin. But then we have information coming about our body that we otherwise wouldn't have access to. Now this is a term that's come out lately called the quantified self. We have the ability today very accurately measure all of the inputs and outputs of the human body. I can very accurately measure the quality of the air that I'm breathing, the quality of the water that I'm drinking, and also the outputs, like the chemical composition of sweat coming out of my arms. This is giving us lots of information to work off of and analyze our diseases and other things going on. This young kid had a 3D printed prosthetic arm. He loves it. Somebody who can print your own prosthetic limb, you can get creative. You can make things that fit your kind of your personality. You do things that are one-off, that you're proud of. This little girl has a 3D printed exoskeleton that gives her a wide range of movement that she never had before. Lee Cronin is a professor at the University of Scotland in Glasgow, and he thinks that we need to actually 3D print all of our pharmaceutical drugs. Now this is very interesting because if you go to a doctor today, a doctor will prescribe medicine for you in a dose like 200 milligrams or 400 milligrams, when the ideal dosage for you at the moment might be 148 milligrams or 367 milligrams. We don't have the ability to work in that level of precision just yet. That's what we're getting to. And if you think 3D printed pills are so far out, this is a Dutch company, or a company in Belgium, that's actually printing pills, not quite the way Lee Cronin thinks we need to, They're not only printing the pills, they're also printing the packaging that they're packaged in. We're also doing lots of experimenting by 3D printing bladders and spleens, and on the bottom right there is ears. And I was wondering, how long will it be before I can actually 3D print a replacement body for myself? I would like one that's probably 18 to 20 years old with a lot more hair, a lot less weight. So can we just go into the closet and pick out a new body? That kind of seems reasonable, doesn't it? I think I want the head with a smile on it today. Okay, another macro trend. Flying and driving drones will touch our lives in ways we can't yet imagine. We've all heard about Amazon delivery drones, and they made quite a splash, but there's lots of problems with delivery drones like this. So first of all, the carrying capacity, because Amazon can only carry 6 pounds, and it's very limited range. So this shows a different type of drone doing the same thing. So that just gives you an idea of what's coming. Now they've actually are working with, that's a company called Transwheel, and they have several of them that they put together, and they can actually carry shipping containers on them. While that's the delivery drone part, most of the flying drones are centered around more observation, surveillance type things with cameras and videos on them. So we're gonna see lots of these. We are going to reach 1 billion drones in the world somewhere between 2030 and 2032. And they're taking off in interesting ways here. So I wrote a column recently on 192 future uses for flying drones. And I'm pretty sure I just scratched the surface with these. Some of them like emergency warning drones. If you've got a flood that's going on, you can send out drones to warn everybody. Insect killing drones. P.O. box drones, we have our mail delivered to P.O. boxes, and at some point in the day, each of our P.O. boxes turns into a drone and it flies our mail right to us. I really like that idea. Send it back drones, if you have something you want to return to a company, you just order a drone to send it back. Food and product sampler drones. Bird frightening drones, if you're growing sunflowers, you want to scare the birds off. And prankster drones. Yeah, I'll show you an example of a prankster drone here. Yeah, you needed that on Halloween, didn't you? We can use drones to inspect things that are very difficult for humans to reach, the top of windmills. Top of power lines, dangerous areas where it's hard to get in there and safely monitor what's going on. We can do thermal scans on buildings, structural integrity of different objects. We can monitor construction projects on the other side of the world. We can actually monitor crops on the other side of the world and the shipping and receiving, the logistics supply chain. We can survey large fields very quickly with lasers and a drone flying over. Some of the other 192 future uses, dog retrieval drones, bird migration trackers, tool loading libraries. So if you're at home and you need to have an electric drill, you can just order one up and have a drone fly it to you. Emergency equipment lending library, so that if you need emergency lighting or power generators. This is the type of drone that I would really like here.
It's pure magic.
This is a Canadian inventor. This just came out a couple weeks ago.
The magic of flight that has captured our imagination since Orville and Wilbur Wright. Now unleashed in its simplest form by the imagination and intelligence of this young Canadian inventor.
That's how he lands it. Pretty cool, huh? This is a company that's actually testing out delivering food to the table in a restaurant with a drone. And I looked at this and I thought, wow, whirling blades and chopsticks, how could that go wrong? This is the one we all need, is the emergency beer drone. So farmers are going to be some of the early adopters of drones. And they can use it in lots of different ways. We can put on herbicides, pesticides, insecticides through these drones. We can also, this is a former NASA engineer that's decided that he wants to plant 1 billion trees a year by dropping these seed pods all over the world. And just making a few scans across a field, we can get tons of information about the crop diseases, about the fertilizer levels in the field, moisture content, things like that. We can monitor our livestock. Emergency rescue drones, rather than putting people in harm's way, we can actually send the drones out with thermal scanners. All the news organizations are going to have drones that are to see who can get out there the fastest and get the first coverage of some incident. Every city, when an emergency call comes in, the first response will be to get eyes on it, and then they can formulate a good response for it. We have the potential to eliminate forest fires completely. We can put drones, high-flying drones, with sensors on it that are monitoring hotspots that's within a forest. So rather than waiting for it to turn into a big blaze, and it's very easy to put out a fire when it's this big, once it turns into hundreds of acres, that's a whole different story. But once we see the small fire, then we can send in the fire extinguisher drone to put it out. But lest you think that drones are just flying, drones can also roll along the ground. They can also stick to the side of a building. They can float in a river. They can dive underwater. They can jump onto a building, and I've seen them actually jump onto a two-story building. They can climb a tree. They can attach themselves like parasites to the sides of cars and trains and airplanes. And so a lot of the drones in the future are going to have multiple capabilities. Peter Diamandis, the founder of the XPRIZE Foundation, says that we're transitioning from a world where 2 billion people were connected to the internet in 2010 to 7 billion in 2020. And what he's talking about is this type of technology. Google has bought a company called Titan. This is a solar-powered drone, the wingspan of about a 747 that takes off, and it flies at a very high altitude, 80 to 90,000 feet in the air, right at the edge of the atmosphere, and it's like a low-flying satellite. These are intended to, this will be above the weather patterns, above the traffic patterns. This is intended to provide Wi-Fi for the other 3 billion people on Earth. Facebook has their own version of this, a company called Ascenta, and they're still working on this. Titan actually had a crash of their vehicle, so they got set back a little bit. The only one of these that has flown so far is the Zephyr by Airbus. So these things are coming, and they're going to create kind of these configurations up there flying around on the top of the atmosphere. Theoretically, they can fly over a hurricane, and they never have to come down. They're solar powered, so they can stay up for 5 years at a time. That's what they're saying. Driverless cars are going to make driving a thing of the past. This was the car that Mercedes introduced at Consumer Electronics Show in January.
Please go ahead.
idea of driving is going to change dramatically. Incidentally, virtually every car company in the world is working on a driverless division. These are just some of them out there. The trucking industry is going to adopt this sooner than the automobile industry. Freightliner already has a driverless truck in operation. But this will introduce on-demand transportation. So if you think about 10 years from now, you step out in front of your house, you punch in your smartphone, I want to go to work, I want to go to school, I want to go shopping. A driverless car comes and picks you up and takes you to where you want to go, and from there it picks somebody else up and takes them to where they want to go, and on and on and on. So it shifts us from a just-in-case mindset to a just-in-time mindset. I have a car in my garage just in case I need to go somewhere, but I don't need a car if I can summon a car and have it there just in time whenever I need it. That's a radically different way of thinking about it. And we'll shift from the driver experience to the rider experience, because we don't care about what it's going to be driving, because we're not going to be driving it. It also eliminates the human variable. So rather than shaving in the car and putting lipstick on and text messaging, we don't have to worry about that. So a lot of positive things. We eliminate 31,000 traffic deaths every year, potentially. 5.5 million accidents, lots of freedom for seniors, people that don't have driver's license, and lots of things are going to go wrong at the same time. I mean, we're going to hear lots of news stories about an 8-year-old kid that got in a car and he went to Texas. Probably the worst state the 8-year-old kid should go to, but this is what an intersection will look like in the driverless car era. Kind of mesmerizing, isn't it? Just so you know, this is what India actually looks like right now. So. So we're entering a world of mega projects. We're going to have lots of big projects that we're going to start working on. And the reason for the mega projects is because politicians are going to be looking at how do we keep people employed. We should actually tackle a big project to keep people employed. And so I'll just mention one of them here. Elon Musk is working on something called Hyperloop. There's another version of this called ET3 that Daryl Oster is working on. He's based in Colorado. They're a little bit different, but we're shipping more things through pipelines than through all other forms of transportation combined. So we have water lines, oil lines, sewage lines. We're shipping lots of things through pipelines, so why not people and freight? This is one of the Hyperloop teams, Dick Alborn. He's working on putting this test track together out in California. It'll look something like this, and he's slated for this to be put together in 2016. The other team is run by Shervin Peshavar, Rob Lloyd, and Peter Diamandis is on the board of directors. And they're working on bus-size vehicles that seat 28 people that can actually travel around 750 miles an hour from one place to another. Here's an animation that UCLA has done on this. Now, it's important to understand that once something's seems realistic, something seems viable, and by watching an animation like this, suddenly it seems, oh, well, that seems very doable, because there's an animation. So this just gives you a quick idea of what this would be like. You put these vehicles in the tube, you take all the air out of the tube, and you shoot it down the tube. But if you can actually take all the air out, maglev track on the bottom, there's just virtually no resistance. So Daryl Oster has figured out a way to scale it down so it's more car-sized vehicles that only seat 6 people, and you can achieve speeds of up to 4,000 miles an hour. That's a whole different ballgame. Daryl Oster refers to this as space travel on Earth. You get 6 people in a capsule and it just go screaming down the tube. Now, we can connect underwater or through elevated lines across the Bering Strait and connect Asia with North America. We can ship lots of cargo in these things. But Cleveland to Beijing in 2 hours, how about that? Realistically, somebody could wake up in the morning and they could have breakfast in Cleveland, they could have lunch in Beijing and dinner in Helsinki. They do that because they can. This has the potential to become the world's largest infrastructure project. Once they prove out that this is viable, that they can make tube transportation systems viable, that every country in the world is going to want to tie into this because it changes things so dramatically. Potentially a 50-year build-out, massive infrastructure employing hundreds of millions of people, but it'll pay for itself on the way. All right, the next macro trend. Future skills are driving future education. So the role of education is changing. It's no longer possible to predict the educational needs of business 4 to 5 years in advance. See, we're currently preparing students for jobs that don't exist, using technology that hasn't been invented to solve problems that we don't even know are problems yet. That pretty much sums it all up. Last year in February, Facebook bought Oculus Rift for $2 billion. Now this is a virtual reality company. And if you don't know what Oculus Rift is, you put this headgear unit on, you have the stereoscopic vision, you're seeing two images simultaneously, and it makes you feel like you're immersed in that new world. It's quite dramatic because once you put these on, you're shifted into a whole new world.
What if we could go beyond the screen? Where your digital world is blended with your real world. Now we can. This is the world with holograms. What will they enable us to do? New ways to visualize our work.
You know, I have an idea for the fuel tank.
New ways to share ideas with each other.
How are things going your end?
I just put the images in OneDrive.
Perfect.
More immersive ways to play. New ways to teach and learn.
So put the new trap in the place of the old one.
Now what?
And tighten here and here.
New ways to collaborate and explore the places we've never been.
Look at this formation. Let's take a closer look.
And new ways to create the things we imagine. Because when you change the way you see the world, you can change the world you see.
Looks like fun, doesn't it? So when Facebook bought Oculus Rift, there was an instant uptick in the demand for virtual reality developers, coders, engineers, producers, and nobody was teaching it. Anybody that was teaching the virtual reality stuff wasn't teaching the Oculus Rift version of it. In May of last year, European court ruled that we have the right to be forgotten. Instantly, Google got hit with 70,000 requests to take down 250,000 websites. See, this right to be forgotten suddenly got reinterpreted to mean that we don't have the right to be forgotten, we have the right to be favorably remembered. So that's a radically different way of thinking. But this instantly created the need for more reputation management professionals. And while some people were doing this, it ramped it up significantly. Lots more job openings there. So bold companies are instantly triggering the need for new talent at cutting edge industries. This is creating the need for what I call micro colleges. By 2030, we've projected out that by 2030, the average person had better plan to reboot their career 6 times throughout their life. A micro college is an intense form of post-secondary education. So this is a bad fit for traditional colleges because they like to put everything in 2 to 4 year blocks. Somebody who has to reboot their career that often wants to do it in far quicker fashion. So at the Da Vinci Institute that I run, we have our own micro college where we're teaching people how to become computer programmers, 11 to 14 week courses, and they are getting a foothold into the computer world. And lots of people are everywhere from age, 25 all the way up to age 50. We actually have some 16-year-olds too. They get a certificate as a result of this. But we see micro colleges actually going off in 1,000 different directions, teaching people how to design parts for 3D printers, how to become experts in crowdfunding, even dog breeders or brewmasters, drone pilot schools, aquaponics, urban agriculture. So this ties into teacherless forms of education. And we need a lot more teacherless forms of education to meet the demand that we're going to have in the future. This is a picture of me on stage in Istanbul a few months back where I was talking about teacherless education. After my talk, one of the executives from Google came up to me and he said, we're really interested in teacherless education because we want to educate Africa and teachers don't want to go to Africa. That was a very revealing moment for me because no, teachers don't want to go to Africa. They don't want to go to Siberia. They don't want to go to Pakistan. There's lots of places in the world that teachers don't want to go. In fact, we're short 18 million teachers around the world right now. There's a full 23% of all kids growing up don't go to any school whatsoever. We have a lot of work cut out for us. Clayton Christensen, the Harvard professor that wrote The Innovator's Dilemma, he says that by 2019, half of all K-12 classes are going to be taught online. Now, what he's referring to is half of the classes will be classes that are at the student's pace, topics that they're very interested in, and the other half will be ones that are socially interactive. But we are figuring out ways to do things virtually that we could never do before. This is actually an interesting form of therapy for people that are in serious accidents, people that are veterans of war. They're teaching people how to use their limbs and help with PTSD problems. So we're going to invent new ways of learning things along the way. We can actually know what it's like to jump out of a plane without actually doing it. Kids can actually get a sense of what life was like in 5th century China just by donning one of these headgears. And especially like this one, a fan in the front, and they have wings on it, so it gives the feel of what it's like to actually fly. I always wanted to do that. If we continue to have to insert teachers and everything between us and everything we need to know in the future, we cannot possibly keep up with the growing demands of business. As Albert Einstein says, education is the progressive realization of our own ignorance. Boy, isn't that the truth. The future is ours to write. So I'm going to leave you today with a few predictions here. The first one is that our most valuable land in the future will be our landfills. That's where all the raw material is. We just throw it all in our landfills. So we're going to develop robotic earthworms to go in there to mine it all out, grind it all up, put it in 3D printers, and we can print it all out into something useful. Maybe. The next major league sport's gonna be video games. I hear some cheering over in this section, but not over on this side. The Electronic Sports World Cup, they're already offering $1 million prizes for these electronic gaming events. In South Korea, They have 45,000 people attending these tournaments. That's pretty significant. Cable TV will disappear by 2030. The cord cutters are finally going to win. The Internet of Things will virtually eliminate theft. We can tag anything of value, and we know where it is at any time. Of course, we might just create a higher caliber of criminal at the same time. So, the world's first trillionaires are going to come from the cryptocurrency movement. Now, Bitcoin, when Bitcoin first came out, it was open source. So virtually anybody could go in there, use the same code, and create their own cryptocurrency. So lots of people did. Now we have over 3,200 cryptocurrencies in existence. Only 28 of them, though, have gotten any traction. So we still have a long ways to go on that. Driverless cars will change transportation as dramatically as the invention of the automobile itself. By 2030 to 2035, we're going to start seeing the first roads that are designated as driverless only. You can only pull your vehicle on this road if you can throw it into driverless mode. Driverless cars will cause accident rates to plummet, auto insurance industry to die. Traffic cops and traffic courts will be out of a job. Yeah, it couldn't happen to a nicer group. By 2030, the average person will have friends with homes that have not been connected to traditional water lines, will interact with over 10,000 sensors on a daily basis, will own a coffee maker that's smarter than they are, will take medicines that are hyper-individualized specifically for them. By 2030, the average person will own printed clothing, will live in a printed house, have packages delivered by drones, will own more than one robot, frequently use a driverless car, be 3 times more educated, will be able to accomplish 10 times, maybe 20 times, as much as the average person today. We are entering a period of unprecedented opportunity. This is going to cause lots of problems, but we need to look at these problems as opportunities. Why is this period so important? Humanity is going to change more in the next 20 years than in all human history. At the same time, risk factors are going to increase exponentially, and our children's children, who haven't even been born yet, are counting on you. They're counting on the people right here in this room. As Steve Jobs says, right now is one of those moments when you are influencing the future. But sometimes our best efforts just look a lot like this. Pretty much just like that. Thomas Edison says, opportunity is missed by most people because it's dressed in overalls and looks like work. I happen to agree with that. So any of you that would like more information about what we do at the Da Vinci Institute or with our Visionarium project, feel free to sign up for a free newsletter. And I thank you very much for having me here today. Thank you.
We're here at the Made in Medina County exhibit here in the fairgrounds, and here with Bethany Dentler and Kimberly Marshall. And I guess, Kimberly, we'll both start with you. How are things been going today?
Well, it's been a great day, sort of a whirlwind, a lot of things happening. We had our keynote speaker this morning, Thomas Frey. We've got about 40 manufacturing companies. 40, 45 manufacturing companies set up showing their products, talking about career opportunities with our students, and just giving out information in general about who they are, what they do, where they're located. So it's been awesome so far.
And then you got to spend a lot of time with Thomas Frey. How was the presentation? What did people think about it? What kind of feedback did you hear about that?
Everybody that I'm talking to really said we hit a home run. It's been a great presentation, very thought-provoking, kind of crazy. Some of the stuff that he was talking about is really out there, but it gets you thinking about, for me, I sort of feel like I'm a dinosaur, but for the students, I felt like this is going to be really for them. Like they, I think it was a real eye-opener, so I'd like to hear Bethany's thoughts too.
Yes.
Well, it was kind of interesting, and I was sitting next to Kimberly during the presentation, and as he was talking about all these crazy trends and robotics and, you know, vacuum tubes that go 700 miles an hour, I leaned over and told Kimberly, I said, but all of that stuff still needs to be manufactured. So there might be a lot of automation, but there's still going to be a need for manufacturing, you know, 15, 20, 40 years in the future.
Yeah, and that's what we saw here, a lot of the made in Medina, a lot of the manufacturers here. You were kind of walking around the exhibits here and got to see the traffic as it was coming through. What have the vendors been saying and what have the people been saying?
Well, first of all, I'd like to say that this is exactly what we pictured when we put this together nearly a year ago. You know, we've got students here, we've got adults, people from the community who are really learning what's made in Medina County. Just talking to some of the vendors, one of them pulled me aside and said, thank you so much for putting this together. We have needed this. We really appreciate the opportunity. They've had tons of students come by who are very actively interested and engaged. And, you know, I think it's more than just Halloween and, you know, trick-or-treating at a trade show. But the students are really learning about the opportunities here. So this is exactly what we pictured when we put the concept together.
And I think you're exactly right, because you could see the kids, you know, once the presentation was done, they weren't just ready to leave. They took their time. They were actually talking with all the people at the exhibits and really being involved.
Yeah, it's kind of funny. I think some of them were actually a little starstruck. They said, you know, we want our picture taken with the futurists. So there was a group gathered around Thomas Frey so they could get their pictures and who knows, maybe even autograph.
Yeah. And that's going to be a lot of, like you said, a lot of the new ideas and technology that those kids will be able to take advantage of. That we can't even imagine right now that they'll be right on the forefront of as it comes and gets developed.
Concept about smart cities and smart houses and smart coffee makers and some of the stuff that they were talking about, like with drones and sort of the emergency management, it's like, wow, you know what I mean? Like if there's a fire, they could send a drone instead of sending a person into harm's way. So it kind of started making me think like about what we do. What are, you know... Maybe they will come up with like a some kind of special thing for an economic developer. What will we be doing? That's what I'm trying to think about. What's our next?
Delivered by drone to the problem spots.
Right, yeah. Exactly. How are we going to recruit those companies? Because what I was talking to Thomas about afterwards is, you know, a CEO, vice president, he could live anywhere in the world. Mm-hmm. Or maybe the headquarters are here, but all the employees live somewhere else. As long as we get the income tax, that's what we want.
Exactly. And for all, and actually, I guess you guys could touch on this, tying in all three communities, how that play out here today, the cooperation between the city of Medina, Brunswick, and Wadsworth.
It's been a wonderful collaborative. We could not have done this without everyone being on board. All hands were truly on deck from every corner of the county. And, you know, I've got to give Kimberly a lot of credit here because it was really her brainchild. She came to me 9-10 months ago and she was like, I have this idea. And I said, okay, but we got to make it bigger. So great idea, Kimberly.
Thank you.
And yeah, well, now that you made it bigger, are we going to see more than this? Is it going to be a repeat performance, an annual event?
Well, you know, what we're hearing from the vendors, what I'm hearing from the vendors and the exhibitors is they want to do this every year. Our sponsors are already coming out of the woodwork saying we wanted to do it again. We haven't really thought about that. We haven't thought that far into the future yet. However, we are going to get our steering committee again together again to sort of debrief what worked, what didn't work, what were our lessons learned along the way, and if we were to do it again, what, you know, when would we do it? Would it be annually or every other year? We're not really sure yet, but it sounds like the general consensus is everybody wants to see this every year. And like for our manufacturing companies, I think they felt like this was a good value. That's what some of them are telling me. Everybody's giving me the thumbs up. So if they're happy, then they'll tell more of their business associates, and I think it will continue to grow. So.
You know, definitely a great event here today. It's been great to televise it and have a great speaker like Thomas Frey in here, and great to see all three cities and the county as a whole come together and just really show all the wonderful things that are done here in Medina County. So it's been a pleasure, and congratulations to both you guys on pulling this off. I know it took a lot of work to get to the point we are here today. So I'll let you get back to the vendors and enjoy the rest of your day.
Thank you, Jerry.
All right, thank you.